what's meant by lyrical poetry? Well, in the context of the classical tradition, we're thinking about the ode. We have previously discussed in the ballad context of the classical epic, we stated that Beowulf could be seen as a compendium of ballads straining to become a fully-fledged epic. But a ballad can be considered more than just the proto-epic. You know, a ballad, like a ballet, becomes ballare, meaning dance, as does the word ball. It was a part of what became categorized then as lyric poetry because it's almost lyricized in its own rhythm. It can sit alongside a sonnet, meaning little sound or song, and then the ode and the hymn. Both are Greek words for song themselves. Further Greek influence in the art of the song and dance are seen from words like chorus, which is round dance, which comes from Greece, the psalm and the lyric, which means harp music, from the lyre. And these are basic subcategories from which spend the wider tradition of what Hyatt's going for in chapter 12, which is lyric poetry. So we need to think structurally about how it grew from the classics into the Middle Ages and beyond. So this part, I'm going to talk about the origins, and then with the second part, I'll bring in its growth since the Renaissance. So we know the chorus, right? That comes from ancient Greek tragedy. And the odes comes from their poets, such as Pindar. This is the bedrock. You can think of this as layer one of how we got to lyric poetry. Top of this is going to sit like a plethora, separate layers, going from the Middle Ages upwards through the Renaissance. So a Middle Age layer, for instance, this will be like Provençal troubadours, non-classical in background, but a layer of Middle Ages that came on. And then by the Renaissance, when they tried to fuse the ode back with these Provençal type troubadour songs, there was a lyricism to them, and the lyric poetry became quite integrated in parts. So let's think about, I've come up with about six layers on this. I've tried to boil what Hyatt talks about down to six concrete layers. The bedrock, the lyric poets of antiquity, notably Pindar and Horace. We're thinking about actual figures. We're going to think about Pindar from the Greeks, Horace from the Romans. They sung us the odes. Layer two then becomes the bards and minstrels of the Middle Ages, notably the Provençal troubadours. Layer three is the Renaissance and the reemergence of classical thought. Layer four will be the Baroque, which we'll get into afterwards. And then layer five will be the fresh invocation of the Romantics in the Revolutionary era. Think Wordsworth, think Coleridge. Write Ode to Judy and Ode to France by both of those respectively. And then we move into the lyric poetry of Matthew Arnold and those who lived under the Industrial Revolution, right towards the fin du siècle. So here we're interested mainly in that layer one that I stated, that bedrock, that ode. Greek lyric poetry is inhibited by the extent to which it survives. Okay, it's often fragmentary and elusive. If early lyricism are done by the likes of Strabo and Alcaeus, and they're almost entirely lost, but we know through references of other works that these were important and had impact on people. But even Pindar's work, which exists probably to the best extent, exists in less than half of its original breadth. Old Greek texts are full of encyclopedias of names that we have found no trace of. So it's clear that it was a much wider collection, but we're going to have to boil it down to Pindar because of the restrictions of what was given down to us. The Romans then took some of this and it was transmuted through their works of Horace, Catullus, Sidonius Apollinaris in late Roman antiquity would have had a wider breadth to pick from. So through the Romans, we see the continuation of the tradition, even though some of that original Greek fire is lost. Hyatt seems to think of two tiers of influence. Tier one, as we said, Pindar and Horace. Tier two, Anacreon, Catullus, actors like this, and the author of the Greek anthology. What does an ode contain? An ode contains an emotion stirred and sustained by one or more nobler and less transient events of human life, particularly those temporary physical facts are transfigured, but they're transfigured by something spiritual and eternal. In short, it's an interplay, is an ode, between emotion and reflection. Its form can differ depending on which of the primary classical poets you want to emulate. So Hyatt's going to take us through this. There's a Pindaric ode, and then there's a Horatian ode. The Horatian coming from Horace. But let's look at Pindar. his subject and form. Pindar was around 522 BC to 442 BC. He was Theban-born, though Athenian-trained. And he was full of that whole current of life through the Peloponnese in that 5th century BC. His ode is emotional and quite aesthetic. He has Olympian odes, right? Physical traits and orations. He wants to glorify athletes' family names, often more than the unique personality of the winner. For him, the victory was a unit to be appended upon the existing legend, and that's how he tries to sculpt his Olympian odes. It's not simply a feat for the person, but it's a feat for who everything he represented in the physical and aesthetical realm. So we have an exaltation of nobility there. And their full form is not entirely consistent. They are divided into stanzas. You will divide an ode into stanzas. Poems built on a single stanza are called monostrophic, but most are triadic, taking the form AZP, called strophe, antistrophe, that's the A to Z, and then the P is the epode, respectively. So, antistrophe matches the strophe almost exactly, while the epode is a briefer stanza, differently arranged but on a similar rhythmical basis. Pindar's odes and Pindaric and Greek odes don't rhyme. I mean, almost nothing in Greek poetry is set to rhyme. It's more a rhythmical enterprise. We talked about this with the rhyming of Homer's epic, or the lack thereof. That's a Middle Age, early Renaissance intrusion to think of these odes as rhyming. So let's compare a Pindaric ode stanza to another stanza, hopefully we're familiar with, which is a Renaissance sonnet. So a Renaissance sonnet will go iambic, like that beat, and it'll have a rhyming scheme: A, B, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, E, F, G. That's a quite a clear structure. Pindaric one will go long, long, short, long, long, short, long, short. That's your A, B. Long, long, short, long, long, short. Long short, and then just one long, C, long short, back to B, then three longs, which is D, and then an even shortened version of D called D prime. Then it'll go EF, and continue with two different long strokes of different lengths. So we've got each line will be of a different length, and it's less of a concrete structure in that sense. But there is a rhythm in it, and you can feel it. When you hear it through the original Greek. But even Romans struggled with Pindar. Pindar is a guy who, because of this complex rhythm structure, appealed to the nobility in Rome. The Roman nobility wanted to see themselves inheriting that complex artistic work of Greece and taking it on and being able to take it on civilizationally. Nevertheless, they imprinted their own character on it. Horace is calm, restrained. He's elegant. He's often an enlightened Epicurean, and he said Pindar's poetry was like, for him, Pindar's poetry always read as something like a torrent rushing down, rain swollen from the mountains, overrunning its banks, boiling, roaring. In other words, don't analyze it, but rather get swept up and get swept away. In truth, it's difficult to do this lyric poetry without rhyme, without that music that has been lost to us. We don't have the actual music of the lyre that would have been played alongside this. Pindar seems to be less logical than what we hope for. So again, even though we get the works of Pindar, think of it as fragmentary. We can't recreate that scene of the chorus, the dancing, the great theatre, the intense concentration of the Athenian audience. So there'll always be something removed when you're reading a Pindaric ode, yet you feel that inheritance of great poetry coming down, phantoms of a dance long gone, sort of feeling. So let's look at Horace. Horace is later. He's near in the first century BC. He's born in around 65 BC and dies 8 BC. Lives through the civil wars and the reign of Emperor Augustus. He's Rome's greatest lyricist. His odes differ from Pindar. They're not composed by a single moment, but kind of for Rome itself. There's Roman odes, particularly a subset of his, which are particularly conducive to one another. And he wants to talk about Rome's thriving civilization, its bright future. He preferred the earlier Greek models in that form of Sappho and Alcaeus, of which he would have had more intuition, and which he would have had more of the raw sources for. They came from 7th and 6th century Greece, as opposed to our 5th century Pindar we talked about earlier. Horace compared Pindar to the swan, strong-winged, loud-voiced, soaring above the plain. He compared himself more to the worker bee, diligent, going about little activities and structuring them up. And we shouldn't compare... Pindar is often compared to an eagle, flying far above the plains, soaring. But Hyatt says that the eagle itself is to be feared as much as admired. That's not really what we feel when we read Pindar. And he prefers Horace's allusion to him as the swan. Pindar, think of Pindar as like the representative of the whole choir, the festival, the many-footed dance of Greece. And Horace as the solo singer, sitting in a pleasant room or quiet garden with his lyre. Horace, in his own way, is like a classical constraint brought on the Pindaric version of the ode, similar to how, even in the Baroque era, which we'll get into, they constrained the classical conception so much so that it became almost suffocating and then it erupted in Romanticism. Think that almost like of a going back to Pindar from Horatian constraints. That's not to say we focused on Pindar and Horace there, and I do think, you know, when we went through Hyatt's version of Chapter 9, the pastoral, there were the two, right? Virgil's bucolics and Georgics, and then Theocritus's idylls. There were two characters which you felt you should read as a concrete block before going into and understanding the Renaissance as it bloomed out of the pastoral, as it bloomed out of the Renaissance. We're kind of similar here with the ode. Let's just strip it down and focus on Pindar from Greece and Horace from Rome. But that's not to say there were others. We already mentioned Anacreon, but we know him more famously through his imitators. The imitators were called Anacreontics, and they created works, you know, more simple and possibly more derivative than the original lasting one. Though famously, the Star Spangled Banner comes from an Anacreontic song called Anacreon in Heaven. And from Rome perspective, we mentioned in the second tier Catullus. Now, Catullus has become more famous, more included in the classical tradition than I think, certainly before Hyatt's time, and it was just starting as Hyatt was writing his classical tradition that you could include Catullus more. He was very raunchy, so you couldn't include him in the young, in teaching the young their classics. His life is short and passionate, as are his own poems. His love lyrics are sort of there for intensity of feeling, almost deranged, delirious infatuation.